Hi, I'm John, and welcome to Edgetone Studios. In part three of my console restoration video, I ended on a cliffhanger. My board had started smoking. What was wrong with it? What was going to happen? Well, you'll soon find out, and you'll find out even more about how much progress I've made. So let's get to it. After my console started smoking last night when I turned it on, I decided to take a few minutes this morning before heading to Victoria to do some investigation. So I've taken out quite a few of the modules. The smoke was coming out of the little slot right here. It seemed like it was coming from this area. There was nothing coming out underneath, so it wasn't the power supply. So currently, everything is up and working, no smoke, and basically I'm replacing one channel strip at a time after powering it off, powering back on, seeing what happens. And I got to figure out why these APU meters, which previously lit up, don't light up anymore. So that's what's going on today in the first day of June, month three of owning this beast. So one by one, I tested console strips and faders, powered the system up, checked whether any smoke was coming out, and there wasn't any smoke. I powered things off, put the next one in, and continued on for quite some time. Okay, I found the problem. It had nothing to do with the console strips or the master section. It's the computer-assisted faders. This ribbon cable started burning. And that burned right up there. That's where all the smoke was coming from. So now I've got to figure out why, but I can just leave this out for the moment. So on the whole, that's good news. Okay, I tracked down an electronics store in Chemainus, which is just 20 minutes away, and went there and brought the wrecked cable, and lo and behold, he had the same type of cable. It was in a package that still said Tandy Electronics on it, which is pre-Radio Shack Radio Shack, and it's pretty well the same type of cable, so I'm going to put the ends on it and try it out. Hope it works. So I got to work on disconnecting the cable ends, and thankfully I do a lot of miniature painting and have a nice magnifying glass, so I was able to see close up at the connector and see if there's any bent pins. Everything looked good. Well, I've got the new cable assembled, and the big question is whether or not my cat's going to walk in the way. Hello, kitty. Kitty. So there's the new cable all assembled, and the big question is whether I lined up the ribbon well enough for the pins, and we'll find out in a sec if it catches on fire or not. Right, kitty? Right? Okay, I now have a replacement cable that I just assembled from the ribbon cable I purchased. There it is in place, and we're going to find out together if it's going to smoke or not. So let's turn on the main power, the phantom power, not that we need it, and the automation power supply. And interestingly, oh, they are lighting up. I was going to say that's not lighting up there, but everything is lighting up. Yep, it's smoking. Same problem. So there's something wrong in the circuitry itself, or I really did the cable poorly. Okay, well, that was a waste. Console update. What's going on? I've got some monitors that are hooked up. I've got the console on. I've got three channel strips in, but I'm only working on the first two. I found two faders at work. I've got a laptop, I've got Studio One, I've got a 16A by Motu. And what you're hearing now is my voice going down channel one through that fader, well, not through that fader, through that knob fader into Studio One, through that channel, echoed back out to this fader, which I could adjust to be quieter or louder. And on top of that, I could just mute this microphone after I put it in its stand. Switch over to my music app. And we have glorious sound. So although I had sound, the computer automation system was disconnected at this point in time because of that burnt cable. But then my friend Pierre, who's a tech, came and did some troubleshooting with me, and we thought we got it to a point where it was no longer smoking, but the automation system wasn't working. Well, later it turned out that the cable just was not powering to the point where it could smoke again. Console update. Here's what I'm doing. I've got four working channel strips and four working faders. I've got Studio One set up here, and I've got four instrument tracks, which are just loops from Studio One, and they're going through to mic one, mic two, mic three, mic four. Coming back from the console, I have the line out, which is I'm calling to tape one, two, and three, and four, coming to separate tracks. Those tracks are going into the line inputs on each of the strips, one, two, three, and four, and then playing back through the console strips. I've got the levels down fairly low because I'm driving these like they're a mic signal, but they're actually a line level signal. And I just have input monitoring on the returns. So if I press play, get sound coming through. I got fader mutes working. Levels working. I can assign buses. I've got EQs. All working. And basically what I do is after I test that, I stop this. I do a few more tests with the board itself. I turn the volume down. I turn the power off. I go around to the back of the console and I move the four connectors I have for microphones over by one. Okay, and then I go over to the line and returns and get those in there, just connect them in. And then I take all four of those console strips and all four of those faders and move them over one and test again until I get to the end of the board. So that's where I'm at the moment. There's a lot to go. We've got mutes working. Well, mostly. EQs are working. Punch those in and out. I can take things out of the channel. So much is working. However, I'll play that again. I've got no signal on channel 27. So the first channel that had that was channel 4, and it was a bad ribbon cable connection under the patch bay, but 27, all the ribbon cables patch out fine. So looking to see what that is, and then I do the next four. See. Okay, I'm underneath the console looking into why channel 17 doesn't work. And I was checking all these connectors down here, so the channel strips that I've got in are right up there. So it's these connectors here, and they all seem solid. I pulled each of them, put them back, they look good. But then I looked up at this board here and realized this ribbon cable between the motherboards, they're frayed. This one's got This is where the peanuts were too. I bet you whatever creature was in here chewed on this thing. This might be why the solo bus doesn't work. This one as well. And the last one looks good, but it's underneath the power cable, the ground. So I'll have to do some more investigating and see how to get these out and if I can get some replacement cable for those.
So I got that motherboard out. It wasn't too difficult and was able to disconnect the cable and ended up the next day back at Impulse Electronics in Chemainus, which is a small audio electronics shop that is full of old gear, old cables, old stuff in the back. But thankfully, even though it takes forever to get service or get things paid for, I was able to get the components I needed. And then I saw that they had another mixer from the 80s. This Roland mixer was also owned by Global TV, and I considered purchasing it for my collection, but then thought better of it.
So I've been working through the console, testing 4-channel strips at a time, and I found that channel 27 did not work. So I'd gotten under the motherboard and or under the console and looked at the cables and found that the motherboard cables were chewed. So I've gotten one of those motherboards out now. Basically one end has a male connector and the other end is connected directly to the board. So I've removed that, cut this off of there. That's the chewed up cable. I've got some replacement cable, so I just got to pop this off, put some new cable on that. But I've got to do that with all these motherboards. So as well, I've picked up some longer screws that will fit in the motherboard. So I'm going to put the washers in after all to raise these up a little bit. So my next step is going to be removing the few modules I have in there and getting under the board and taking out every one of those ribbon cable connections and all those upper motherboards. And then I'll have to do the lower motherboards just to put the washers underneath. Thankfully, they aren't ribbon cable connected. It's only the top that connects together. They all ribbon cable connect over to the master module, the comms module, and the whatever it's called, like the speaker module. It's got a different name. Anyways, on with it.
Next, I removed those last few channels and the master modules and got underneath the console and realized I had to disconnect all the tie wraps that were holding the cables together. So I did that and managed to get to the point where I could start working on getting these motherboards disconnected from the chassis.
Okay, I've managed to get every cable disconnected. I had to cut the tie wraps on some of the ribbon cables so I could get in there. So now all these ribbon cables are hanging down, but I've cut the few as possible so it'll be easier to strap them back in. There's straps all over here, so let's get these motherboards out.
So I'm starting to think that the reason I started this console series is so that I could do a lot of stop motion film work where I just set up the camera and work away and it takes pictures of me working really fast.
Okay, so I've got these boards out and here's the status. The first ribbon cable, as I suspected, is totally fine. Don't see any issues with it other than some dust. The next one's got a rip, probably starting around pin 16 or 17. The last one has a little hole farther down the lines, and the first one that I'd pulled out was ripped right in the middle. And I'll put some new washers under here. So there's a single one there. I might put two more to bring it up quite a bit. Okay, on to that and attaching new ribbon cables.
So with some crazy glue and some tweezers, I was able to get two layers of washers attached.
I just wanted to show you how much I brought these washers up by. There was a single washer on there, and I've added two more. Now I'm going to test this board just to make sure I didn't bring it up too high. Just to give you a sense, there's the difference in screw lengths. That's the short screw is the old one, and the new screw is the longer one. Okay, this will give you a sense of how much of a difference this makes. That slot there has not been raised, and that's how much the circuit board is connecting. And then this one's been raised up.
and it's got a substantial amount further in. It could even go higher, but there's no point. It's enough to make a solid connection. So I'm happy with that. I'll be doing that with all these boards. Maybe the faders, maybe not. I don't know if I'll bother.
So while the guts of the console lay strewn all across my games room table, I got underneath the console and took pictures of all the connections for the main board, which is the master module. It had the most cables in it. The other ones were very straightforward. And once I had those documented, I was able to get under and start disconnecting the boards themselves.
Okay, I've taken out the master module motherboard, and it's a bit of a pain because it's got so many ribbon cables connected to it. And there's this one wire that connects way down the board. Let's see if you can see it way down there. And I didn't want to disconnect that, so I just flipped it over and putting the washers on from this side, and hopefully I can remember where all these cables go. I did take some pictures, but it was pretty hard to see everything. Okay, here.
The next day I got started on disconnecting all the rest of the lower motherboards. And because each of them had one of those cables attached, I flipped them over in the chassis and attached the washers while they were in place. And as soon as those were dry, I would flip them back over and reattach the motherboard into the chassis. And then I would screw that motherboard back in place with my longer screws. And once it was seated in place, I'd get underneath the console again and reattach it, and then detach the next one until all of them were done.
Okay, I've been working late on the console because I really want to get these motherboards back in. So I'm at the point where all of these have had washers put underneath. They're all cleaned with circuit board cleaner. All the connections are back. And now I can see a lot more grunge in the ribbon cables there. I'm going to vacuum that out tomorrow or the next day. I'm out of town tomorrow. So all the other motherboards have their washers attached. I just got to make sure that I get the ribbon cables on there, and then I can get everything reassembled and start testing again. That's going to be great.
Now I'd managed to track down some wider cable from a store in Victoria. And I needed 50-pin cable to be able to connect the motherboards, and I was lucky enough to find some colorful Pride colors for Pride Month. So it didn't take much time to get these connectors crimped and get the upper motherboards to the point where I could put them back into the chassis.
Okay, I've got my new ribbon cable connections in place. There's a new one there. A new one there, a new one there, all in light, nice Pride Month colors. And then the old one is still functional, so we'll see how this goes. Okay, my ribbon cable replacement is done, and I was attempting to fix the issue with channel 27 when I found those chewed up cables. And now that they've been replaced, channel 27 still isn't working. So other things are working though. But hit play here, take it off mute. I've got volume. I've got my various mutes. Well, that one doesn't matter because it's not working. I've got all of my sends working, as you'll see. So if I come over here, that's the two mix we're listening to. So if I go to send one and two, now we're listening to send one and two. There's 3-4, so if we come over to say 3-4 here and take something out of the mix, there's 3-4. I'll switch back to 1-2. 3-4. There's 5-6. 5-6 is a stereo mix here, so I can pan things. Not that you can hear it on a mono phone. Turn volumes down. So that's cool, but even better, it's fixed my solo issue. So if I hit solo, I now can adjust the solo trim. The solo light comes on. I could solo a couple things. I could unsolo that. I could take the solo off. And dim still. Oh, so good. I've got so much working. I don't know why 27 isn't working though. There's obviously nothing wrong with those boards because I've kind of swapped them around. So it could be something in the line on one of the circuit boards. I think the ribbon cables are solid now, so I'll just keep testing strips and see how many more have major issues. I may have solved most of the problems with the system. So good. Okay, so what I've done now is I went under here. I pulled out the ribbon cable for 27. I put the one for 26 into channel 27. And as you can see, I'm getting signal through 27. It's going down the channel. And if I turn this on, that's the baseline that's supposed to be coming through there. So that strip is working and it's able to send to the patch bay through 26. So I'm thinking it's a patch bay issue and might be the ribbon cable in the patch bay, but I couldn't see anything disconnected there. So that shouldn't be too hard to fix because that whole strip basically works. It just works through channel 26 instead. Okay, more to come. Okay, now I've patched number 28, the mic pre-out, directly into the line out on 27. And that's putting signal through 27, so 27 patch bay is working there. However, if I put it back into the pre-return, I don't get anything. So I'm thinking it's something in the patch bay at this point. And if I do it the other way, if I take the pre-out of 27, and put that into the line in of, or even the mic pre-return of 28. Then when I go to 28, I should get the bass, and I don't. So it's something in there. So before I tie up the cables all back up, I got underneath there and wiped them all down so they're a lot cleaner. And guess what I found? More peanuts.
Well, since I was having trouble with the patch bay, I figured I had to do the painstaking task of disconnecting all the patch bay ribbon cables so I could start pulling out connectors. So I carefully took each one of those out, removed the patch bay covers, and then took out slot number 27.
Okay, so I've pulled out one of the TT patch bay slots. This is number 27 that isn't working. And I thought I'd give you a close-up view of how modular this console is. I mean, look at that. It's just a ribbon cable that connects to the bottom that goes to slot 27 and then the various connection points. I'll do a close-up here. So as you can see, when you take the TT out, there's normally closed contacts between those two pins and those two pins. And when you put the connector in, it makes connection on the jack there and disconnects on those. So I'm seriously considering pulling every one of these now that every ribbon cable's off of there and just cleaning them all with contact cleaner, because why not? It's open. Might as well.
And of course, that's what I did. I removed every single one of those patch bay slots and then took them out onto the driveway and sprayed them all with contact cleaner. And then thought I was about to reassemble the patch bay itself.
So while the patch bay connectors are all drying, thought I'd take a look at what these extra cables that are coming out into the extra patch bay, which is all the sends for sends and returns for the send buses, the chamber in and out. So that's your reverbs and delays, etc. Your sends, the meters, send and returns for the tape, etc. And then a whole bunch of patch points for external gear. So I pulled one of these channels out and it looks like someone's just soldered on a cable here so that they can patch something else in. But all this connectivity goes through the ribbon cables, goes to the back of the board to the two-shell connector, so I don't see any reason to have those. So looks like I'm gonna have to pull each of these and just take those cables off because they're unnecessary. As far as I know, I'm gonna double check that. Well, that wasn't too hard. Quick little desolder and those are off. So now I've just got, looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more
channels that I want to remove. So let's get to those.
So after desoldering the six or eight different random cables that were from the previous owner, I was able to put all the patch bay modules in for the channel strips and get back to my testing.
Okay, the patch bay is back together and everything is connected. I've got my four strips in there. I've got everything on. I've got my sample four tracks that I play. When I get them going, you can hear the bass line going, which is on 27 there. So 27 is now working, but look at 25. Not working. So I went underneath the patch bay, wiggled that cable, and found it was intermittent. So I think there's a bad crimp on that cable. I'm gonna have to re-crimp. And I guess I'll leave those untie wrapped until I've gone through every strip again. Oh, so much work. Okay, after crawling around under the console a bunch more, disconnecting the wrong cable, starting to get ready to crimp it, realizing it was the wrong cable, getting the right cable, doing some more testing, finding out that cable for 25 worked fine if I plugged it into 26 and vice versa, so it's not a cable issue, I suddenly realized that maybe I just disconnected my mic cables under here, so I reseated those and voila, 25 is going. Got all four channels working. So good, I can move on to the next four channels now after 5 days of work. Not bad. So this is the type of frustrating thing that happens when you're tired and you've been working on a console for a long time. So I moved the four fader strips over and I looked and went, okay, 31 is not working. I tried my mutes, I checked the software, I went and checked the cables at the back, I powered things off and got ready to shut everything down. Then I thought, well, let's take a look at the strips again. I realized that while moving the strips over, the DIR button got undepressed and it was not sending a direct signal through anymore. So little things like that. I mean, this is just a loopy little thing I made to test this strips, but the speaker sounded amazing, and these are just some $400 JBLs I picked up to test with. So, looking forward to having this all working. Okay, I've now tested the last four channel strips, so that means I've tested every one, although I've completely reconfigured the patch bay or repatched it since doing the first one, so I'm just gonna assume they're all working. I've seen VU meters on each. I have four working strips, four working faders. So the next step is to start finding all the other working strips and faders and documenting exactly what's wrong with each module so that they can be repaired or replaced. I've got two more spares coming, so I'll have three spares. Maybe that'll be enough that I'll have everything working without having to do too much actual audio repair. That's it for now. So many modules to put back.
So besides the extra spare modules I'd ordered, I managed to track down new computer automation modules. They were only $20 each, so I figured they were worth picking up and see if they're going to fix my ribbon issue. They have not yet arrived, but I got all the strips back in and then started testing things and I've course ran into issues, so I pulled most of them out and once again started just adding things one at a time. So really that is the way to do it, no matter how much you desire having every console in the board and having it look amazing. You really need to add things one at a time until you know exactly what is working.
Okay, I interrupted this time lapse to show you something. Every one of these strips has a nut that acts as a washer. So these things can get stuck partway down the screw, and then when you try and screw it into the base, they'll just jam right up. So before putting each channel strip in, I have to wind those right on so they're fully on before I use it, the drill on it, or else, you know, jam, pull them back out again.
And no matter how much I reminded myself of that, there were so many times where I went to put the drill in and I had to pull a module out to get those nuts, washer nut things back. There's me doing it a couple times. But like I say, eventually I filled this whole thing up and then had to pull it all out again to get to the point where I could test things one at a time. But it was nice to see the board fully assembled, minus the accoutrements of wood and padding, and all the channel strips in there. So I did some shots of the board using my camera. I stopped using the digital camera at this point in time. I was using my phone camera because I found it just generally gave better pictures. And I thought I'd give an overview of the whole board itself so you could see all these glorious knobs and switches, all those VU meters. I mean, this thing is freaking amazing. This is 1986. I don't know how much of it was hand soldered, but I'm sure there was some good component of it that was. There's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of buttons that make connections for each of the buses, for each of the mic preamps, for the gain, for the phantom power, the patch bay, the master modules. I'm missing a few original faders, but I've got most of the original components here. So I'll give you an overview of the channel strips here. At the top, you've got the 24 bus connections, or you can go direct and bypass the bus altogether. If you used pairs of buses, you can pan between them. You've got line level control. You've got your mic gain and phantom power. A four-band EQ where the top and bottom bands can be peaking or shelving. Each of those could be in or out of the channel or the line input. There's also a high cut and variable low cut filter. Then the four sends and the one stereo send, your solo and your mute, your pan, and the smallest fader for tape level.
Quick console update. So I've got most of the repairs complete of the things that I found wrong with it anyways. And now I've been testing modules. And as far as I can tell, every single one of the channel strips, including these ones that aren't in there, are working. I've got several faders that don't work. I'm taking copious notes of what's working, what's not working. And now it's a matter of figuring out the weird little issues where some pan pots don't work fully, or some channels have a problem between the preamp and the EQ and there has to be bypassed for it to work, stuff like that. But it's moved along significantly since things were burning.
Now, the next thing I ran into is that when I got to 26 or more channel strips in the console, I started having bizarre issues that I didn't take pictures of. But basically, first, all the send lights would come on to about 25%. And then if I added all of them in, the plus 18, minus 18 lights that show the voltage going into the console would dim right down as though it's drawing way too much power. So there is some power issue. Operates fine with 25 strips in, but not more than that. So while I'm waiting for a tech to come and do some actual audio repair and look at the power and other issues, I got going on the surface details, which included sanding down the wood for the console and then deciding on what kind of stain I was going to use for the redo. And I tried a couple darker stains because I was thinking I might want something like a walnut because that's what my current desk is. But after looking at the natural wood compared to the stained wood, Tracy suggested I just keep it as natural as possible. So I look for a natural stain. Unfortunately, it's still yellowed a little bit, but overall I was able to get a nice light color to the wood and you can see the grain quite nicely. While the stain was drying, I got on the armrests. They were a little bit scuffed, so I took some appropriate spray paint that was good for vinyl and gave them a nice coat. It came out with a very similar color, a little bit less browny green, a little bit more bluey gray, which I quite liked.
Okay, I'm looking into the VU meters now, and I have gotten the first set of eight out of the unit. At first I thought I had to take this glass off, and so I got some very small nut drivers to take out these little nuts here. And took the glass off and then realized, oh no, I can just take the whole chassis out. So here's the first one out, and I'm looking at these lights, and although they look like LEDs on the outside, there's no resistor built in, so I'm thinking they are incandescent bulbs. So what I want to do is get these all changed over to LEDs, which looks like a lot of fucking soldering. Excuse my language, but oh my god, so much work. I just wish they were already all working in the same color, but they're not.
Once I'd done a bit more investigating, I did find that these were in fact LED lights already. There, someone had previously put in LED light holders that you just slide the LEDs into. It looks like they've put resistors on the back for these LEDs. I'm just hoping they are the right resistors for the power level that's going through. So while I wait for a tech, I reassembled the whole board, turned everything on, and got a glory shot of what it looks like all together. I'm still waiting on some components, but there is a good chance this board will eventually be fully functional. So that's as far as I've gotten on the console so far. I've got some parts on order. As I mentioned, I have the computer-assisted fader modules coming with a couple extra channel strips. I've got some LED replacement bulbs for the mute switches. I'm still trying to determine what LEDs I'll get to standardize my VU meters, and then I'll update all those VU meters. I've also sourced the parts for the replacement caps for the knobs on all the modules, so I can order those in quantity or just the ones that are broken. I haven't decided if I'm going to replace everything. That would be rather expensive. But I'm going out of my way to make this thing not just functional, but looking as nice as it can. So I may do that as well. So my next step is seeing how long it'll be until tech can get here and actually check things out, hopefully solve the power issue first. Once the power issue is solved, the other issues seem to be minor. Then I'll have to hook up some send and returns for some of the outboard gear and test that functionality. Once that's all going, I guess it'll be calibration of everything, which will be another painstaking process. But hopefully I can learn how to do that myself and then go through and calibrate each and every one of the channel strips and the VU meters and the faders and the output levels and have it to the point where the system is ready to move into this space and replace this desk that I'm sitting in front of right here. That'll be a big day, and that will then require that I rewire every single one of my connections at the back of this desk to be the two-shell connectors for the back of the console, and figure out whether I'm going to need a patch bay between any of the lines coming in here. I think there's enough channels I probably shouldn't, but I might want to keep a couple flexible for rerouting for special gear coming in. So that's it for this portion. I'm not sure how long it'll be for the next video because I don't have an ETA on a tech arriving. But once I get some more updates, I will post an update and show you where it's at. Thanks for watching. Bye.